In today's video, I'm editing this image to produce this finished landscape photo. Hello, I'm Robin Whalley and welcome to Lenscraft. Today I'm completing a typical edit of a landscape photo from start to finish using only Affinity Photo. And I'll be sharing every step with you along the way. I'm starting by opening the original RAW file in Affinity Photo. Because this is a RAW file, Affinity immediately switches me into the Develop persona. Now, an important point to remember when using Develop persona is that it's a destructive edit. Whilst it doesn't damage the original RAW file, it does lock in your adjustments to the image. Once you leave the Develop persona, you can't return to change your adjustments. Because of this, I want to limit my adjustments to the essentials in the Develop persona. My aim is to create the best quality starting image that I can. I'll then apply the rest of my adjustments in the photo persona using non-destructive editing techniques. What I don't want to do is try to produce a finished image in the Develop persona. To help me maintain the image quality, I'll turn on the clipping warning indicators in the toolbar. Then, if any of my adjustments cause clipping, I'll see the areas highlighted on the image. You might have noticed that this image is looking a bit flat and lacking in contrast. That's because there isn't a tone curve applied to it at the moment. Sometimes this flat starting position works well, but sometimes people struggle with it and don't know what's wrong. If you're experiencing this, you can correct it in the Assistant options, which you can open from the toolbar. In the Tone Curve section, I can select to automatically apply a tone curve. Notice how this immediately improves the image. Now I can correct the exposure and tones in the image to create a good histogram. I'll increase the exposure by around 0.5 so the shadows aren't too dark. I'll also reduce the black point slider to -2% as the shadows look a little bit blocked up. The only problem with these adjustments is that they're causing some clipping in the bright areas of the sky. I'll correct that in a moment, but first I want to set the colour profile for the image I'm producing. The default is the sRGB profile, which is a little small for a landscape photo like this, so I'll change it to Adobe RGB. This will help to preserve a wide range of colours in the image during editing. In the Lens tab, I want to apply the chromatic aberration reduction in case there's any coloured fringing in the image. You'll also notice that there isn't a lens profile selected for this image to correct any lens distortion. The image was shot using a Fujifilm XF16-80 lens, but unfortunately Affinity Photo doesn't have a profile for this. But because the lens does have a reasonable amount of distortion at 16mm, which I can now see in the image, I'm going to select another lens profile from the list. I've previously looked through these and found that the 16-55 XF2.8 produces a reasonable correction, so I'll select that. Next, I'll correct the problem with the sky using an overlay to reduce the brightness. Using the Gradient Overlay tool, I'll select the sky. I can then reduce the exposure in the sky by -0.5, which effectively removes the adjustment I applied earlier to the overall image. The sky now looks better, but I can still see some clipping in the red channel in the histogram. I'll fix this using the highlight slider, reducing it by around 50%. The image is now looking about right as a starting position to take into the photo persona for editing. But before I do, I want to apply a small amount of sharpening. To do this, I need to select the master in the overlay section, as it's not possible to sharpen individual areas of the image. Then I can zoom to 100% magnification to apply my capture sharpening. To sharpen the image, I'll use a low radius of around 10% and then increase the amount until it looks about right. All I'm trying to do is sharpen the rocks in the foreground to bring out some of the detail. What I'm not trying to do at this stage is create a very sharp image. I can also see there's a hint of noise in the sky on the left, so I'll apply a small amount of luminance noise reduction. Around 10% should fix it. I don't want to apply too much of this though, or it starts to soften the image. I'm now happy with the adjustments to the RAW file, so I'll click the Develop button. This produces a new image from the RAW file using my settings, and it switches me into the photo persona to continue editing. The first task is to remove some of the parked cars you can see in the distance and on the road. Over on the left side of the image, You can see that there are several parked cars that need to be removed. Start by adding a new empty layer to the image to use for the repair. There are a few tools I could use for this, but the clone stamp tool is probably ideal. You'll find it in the tools palette over on the left. After selecting the clone stamp, I can change the settings in the toolbar so that it's sampling the current layer and below. This allows me to sample an area of the image and use it to make a repair on the new layer. To make the sample, I just hold down the Option key on my keyboard and click on the sample point. Notice the clone stamp shows a preview of the repair, which allows me to line it up. When it looks right, I can click to apply it. I can then work along the road sampling and removing the cars. After removing the unwanted cars, if I turn off the layer, you can see the original image is unchanged. All the repairs were made to the new layer, making this a non-destructive edit. The next adjustment to the image is to correct the tones using a levels adjustment layer. I'll add the adjustment layer by clicking the icon at the bottom of the Layer Studio panel and selecting the levels option. Now I can move the black level to the right until it touches the edge of the histogram. This spreads the image tones across the entire tonal range. I could do the same with the white level, but it looks about right as it is. Now I can move the gamma slider to the left to lighten the image a little, which also opens the shadows. The advantage of making this type of adjustment in the photo persona is that we're using a separate layer. If I later decide it's too strong, I can adjust it further or reduce the opacity setting of the layer. If I had made the adjustment in the developed persona and then later wanted to change it, I couldn't. After correcting the image tones, I want to look at the colours using a selective colour adjustment layer. I can use this to target each different colour range in the image and then adjust it. When I adjust the reds and move the black slider left and right, you can see the areas of the image that it's affecting. This helps me to understand which areas I'll be adjusting with my changes so that I can watch them more closely. Now I'll increase the magenta and reduce the yellow component of the reds. When I'm happy with that, I'll select the yellows where I can increase the magenta, reduce the cyan, and increase the black slightly. Using this approach, you can work through each of the colour ranges in the image. When it comes to the whites, you're affecting the brightest colours in the image. Most of the whites in this image are in the sky, which I'd want to darken by increasing the blacks. I'll also reduce the yellows a little and add some magenta. Be very careful when adjusting the blacks, neutrals and whites because these can easily create unwanted colour shifts. All that I'm going to do with the neutrals in this image is reduce the cyan by a couple of percentage points to warm up the light slightly. Again, because this is an adjustment layer, I can turn it off or reduce the strength of the effect using the opacity slider. Next, it's time to adjust the image contrast with a curves layer. I'll add the new curves layer by selecting the curves option from the Add New Adjustment Layer icon. I don't want the adjustment to affect the darkest tones in the image, so I'll add a point on the curves in the shadow area. This pins it to limit how much it moves. Then I'll darken the shadows and lighten the highlights using two more adjustment points. As with the other adjustment layers, this is a non-destructive edit, so I can turn it off and adjust the opacity to control the strength of the effect. The problem now is that I don't like how this is affecting some of the rocks, and I want to remove that effect in those areas. I'll do this using a soft paintbrush to paint on the adjustment layer mask with black. I'm also using a low opacity setting for the brush so that I need multiple brush strokes, which helps to blend the effect. The rocks are now looking good, but I want to enhance them further by emphasising the gritty surface. To do this, I'll apply a clarity adjustment to the image using a live filter layer. You'll find the live filters in the layer menu. There, select New Live Filter Layer and then Sharpen and Clarity. This attaches the new filter to the layer that we had selected in the Layers Studio panel, which in this example was the curves layer. The problem now is that if we use the filter where it is, it won't have any effect. To fix that, I can drag and drop it onto the background layer. The background layer is a pixel layer containing the image, and so we can see the effect of the clarity filter. Now, if you have multiple pixel layers in an image, you may find the filter effect is hidden by one of those. The solution is to detach the filter from any layer by dragging it to the top of the layer's stack. A lot of people don't realize that it then acts like a regular layer in the image. Now, one of the advantages of the live filter over the regular filters is that you can double-click them to adjust their settings. With this image, I'll push the clarity slider all the way to the right for maximum effect. Then, I'll invert the layer mask to turn it black, which hides the clarity adjustment. Using a soft paintbrush and white, I can then paint over the rocks to add the clarity of the adjustment back in. I'm doing this with the brush set to zero hardness and an opacity of around 30%. When I've finished painting in the effect on the rocks, if it's too strong, I can reduce the strength using even a clarity slider or the filter opacity. At this point, the image is finished, but there are a couple of other things I can do. One of those is try applying a LUT. LUTs are adjustment layers which you can use to load lookup tables. These lookup tables will remap the colours and tones in an image to create different effects. They're used heavily in the film industry for special effects like adding a green tint in a horror film or turning day into night. They're also very useful in still photography for colour grading images to create atmosphere. Affinity Photo comes with a small collection of LUTs which you can access when you add a LUT adjustment layer, but you can also buy more online. After adding the new LUT layer, I can select from the LUTs that I have installed, which I purchased from the Affinity Photo website. For this image, I'll add one named Ellie. This creates a nice colour in the image, but it's a little too strong, so I'll reduce the layer opacity until I get the look I want. You find that a lot of the LUTs are too strong at 100% and need to be reduced like this. This LUT produces a nice subtle colour, but it's removed the blue haze on the horizon in the distance. To bring this back, I can paint on the LUT layer mask using a soft black brush. Keeping the blue haze helps to create a feeling of depth, as the light on the foreground rocks now appears warmer than the distant horizon. As a final step, I now want to add a subtle vignette. I could do this with the Affinity Photo vignette filter, but I don't particularly like that. Instead, I'll show you how I create my own using a curves adjustment layer. Start by selecting the elliptical marquee tool from the tools palette. We'll then use this to draw an ellipse, which will become the vignette. But before I draw the vignette, I'll set the feather to 1000 pixels to give the vignette a soft effect. Now I can draw the ellipse selection on the image. After that, I can add a new curves adjustment layer, which converts the selection we made into a layer mask. I'll then clear the selection using the select menu and choosing the deselect option. Next, change the blend mode for the curves layer to multiply, which darkens the selection. As this is the reverse of what we want, we can invert it by pressing Command and I on the keyboard. Finally, I can use the opacity to control the strength of the vignette. Although the finished vignette looks quite good, there's a further adjustment we can make to improve it. If I select the curves vignette layer and click this cog icon at the top of the layers panel, it opens the blending options dialog. This allows you to control which tones in the image are affected by the adjustment layer. And by tones, I mean how light or dark a pixel is. What I want is to stop the vignette darkening tones that are already very dark in the image. I can do this by dragging the left point of the line and pulling it down to the bottom. At the same time, I'll move the point on the right of the line into the centre. This limits the vignette effect in the darkest areas of the image, but at the same time, it allows the vignette to appear in the lighter areas. If you want to know more about the blend range options, watch this video next. It explains what these lines do and how you can use them to do all sorts of things, including luminosity blending.